Good morning and welcome to the 2020 VA-10 Virtual Academy Day, hosted by Congresswoman Jennifer Wexton. My name is Anthony Barnes. I serve as the Military and Veterans Manager, as well as the Academy Coordinator, Representative Wexton, and I'm pleased to welcome you all here today. This morning, you'll have an opportunity to hear from the five service academies, as well as the Army ROTC program at George Mason University. You'll also hear from the VA-10 Service Academy Advisory Board. This presentation will give you an in-depth look at the highly competitive Academy nomination process for VA-10. But first, to get us started, I'd like to introduce the host of today's event, Congresswoman Jennifer Wexton.
Thank you, Anthony, and thank you to everyone out there for joining us today for our very first virtual Academy Day. This is, notwithstanding technical difficulties, you know, I'm glad that we're able to conduct this important event, even in the times of COVID-19. I want to thank Captain George Siragusa, the entire Service Academy Board, and Anthony Barnes from my staff for making this event a possibility. 33 students from Virginia 10 have received offers of appointment to a Service Academy from our last class of applicants. That's a pretty amazing number, and it's a testament not only to the quality of the applicants, but also to the rigors of the application process. There's no question that we have incredible talent here in our district. And I'm so grateful that today we're joined by representatives from every U.S. Service Academy, the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, New York, the Naval Academy at Annapolis, Maryland, the Air Force Academy at Colorado Springs, the Merchant Marine Academy at Kings Point, New York, the Coast Guard Academy at New London, Connecticut, and we're also so fortunate to be joined by a representative from George Mason University's Army ROTC program and members of our very own Virginia 10 Service Academy Advisory Board. To the students who are thinking about applying to one of these academies, you're here to learn more about the congressional nominations to our service academies, and I want to commend you for embarking on this process. What's become increasingly clear over the years, especially in times of unprecedented crisis like now, is our country's need for steady, responsible leadership. And you may not think of it now, but you are the next generation of leaders our country will come to rely on. So today you're going to hear from some pretty impressive people, and I hope you take what they have to say to heart. Our armed forces are one group in our nation that have always earned the respect of all Americans. And part of that is because our men and women in uniform have always come together as a team, no matter what. Because they understand that we are not red Americans and blue Americans. We are first and foremost Americans, and that's especially important now. So thank you so much for your interest in serving our country, and good luck to you all on this journey.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Appreciate those opening remarks. Next, I'd like to pass it over to our Service Academy Advisory Board Chair, Captain George Siragusa.
Anthony, thanks for the introduction. Congresswoman Wexton, thanks for hosting and appreciate all your support as we go forward. Good morning, prospective candidates and families and friends and colleagues. It's an honor to be here. My name is Captain George Siragusa, USN retired. And in the next few minutes, I'll be speaking to you as the chairman of Congresswoman Wexton's Congressional District 10 Service Academy Board, and offer you, hopefully, a unique look at the steps required, one of two steps required to be considered for one of these four federal military service academies. I'll quickly share with you this morning in this brief three things: a closer look at the nomination process, expectations, and even some tips and techniques for the candidates. I'm going to share with you nomination and appointment statistics from our 2019 board and some closing perspectives. Hopefully I'll answer a majority of the questions that are already coming in as we speak. Next slide, please. Next one, please. Thanks. So, speaking to the candidates now, I think it's important as you begin this journey of discovery that you ask service members you meet a little about their career path. Not because it's important necessarily for them to talk about themselves, but for you to understand a little about where they served and some of their experiences as you make your journey. Just for background, very quickly, I'm a U.S. Naval Academy grad who chose oceanography and surface warfare at the Academy. I started my career in destroyers, taught military courses at Annapolis, and later in my career helped write doctrine for the U.S. Naval Component Commander for NATO. Now I consult and teach at GMU. But what's really important is to understand that you can serve, and as you can see, when we get to the panel, I can uniquely speak to both the private and public sectors because I had careers both in active and in the reserve component. But enough about me, let's get to the process. Next slide, please. Like every good officer would do in a brief, we need to begin with some learning objectives. Here are the two objectives for this morning. Offer the candidates a perspective, if you would, of looking inside the congressional nomination process. And then secondly, to communicate to those candidates who may be listening some points of emphasis for preparedness. And then a note of disclaimer, each congressional district around the country may be different. We'll be speaking to you from a unique perspective from District 10. Next slide, please. So for the candidates that are, prospective candidates that are listening, even before we get into some of the process and tips, I think it's important that some scene, some context. Let me place national military service in context. And this is not meant dramatic. This is simply the reality surrounding the choice that you're considering to make. We are a nation at war, and deployment is a reality. Academies are not just destinations, and the kind of sacrifice and dedication you need to make in this decision are really norms. Commissioning into one of the four branches of service is not a... Back slide, please. Thank you. Commissioning is not job security. It is a call to serve. It is genuine and selfless in its nature. And it's really capped by the late Senator McCain, who said the oath of office is really a serious commitment. And you can see his quote there. So I ask the prospective candidates to think about that as you're making this choice. Next slide, please. So what is our mission? Our mission is really twofold. It's to identify and recommend diamonds in the rough. As the Congresswoman said, we are here to interview and screen candidates and make informed choices for the four federal service academies and other commissioning sources, which brings me to the second point, and that is to do our community outreach, educate, advise, guide, and inspire where we can for young people who are thinking about service to our military. Next slide. A quick overview of the particular process in VA-10 as follows. For the candidates listening, there were about 120 applications received in the Congresswoman's office last year. And our aim is to fill five slots, five openings maximum at any academy at any given time. And to do that, the board that I'll talk about in a second picks 10 candidates. As you can see, there's a symbol there. The Coast Guard Academy does not require nominations, although, as we said earlier, we do advise and coach if somebody's interested. Next click, please. So the Federal Service Academies, there's three Department of Defense Academies and one DOT, Department of Transportation Academy, and that is the Merchant Marine Academy. And to look at those nominations, we do this with a panel of about 50 plus volunteers at any given time. We serve at the request of the Congresswoman, and we conduct the screening interviews between October and December each year. Oftentimes, after these screening sessions, we liaison with the deans of admissions, and as I already said, we coach and advise. Next click, please. Just to put this in perspective, against 120 applications we received statewide, for example, the senator would have received 500 applications. Okay, next slide, please. So let's take a closer look at the nomination board itself. If we could, let's talk about three components, three elements. Let's look at who the advisory board is and how they conduct their mission. Let's discuss tips and techniques for the candidates to prepare themselves. And then I would like to talk to the candidates about those degrees of separation between candidate A and B in District 10, because those those degrees of separation in this very fine congressional district are paper thin at times. Next slide, please. So the board is composed of three members, and those three members would be represented in a cross-branch representation, depending on the concentration of candidate choices. But normally we would have Navy, Marine Corps, Merchant Marine, Army, and Air Force represented by those three members, again, depending on the concentration and choice of the candidates. That diversity of experiences and demographics really helps our decision-making process. Next click. The process we use is really an eyes on. It's not just a paper exercise. It goes beyond just the application. It's looking in a 40-minute competency-based interview methodology to have a discussion with the candidate to understand a host, a variety of things about the desire for that candidate to serve. And that process is supported both qualitatively and quantitatively with a methodology we use for consistent scoring and consensus. Next click. Some key statistics, key dates, milestones that you need to know about. In May, we usually post the applications, and in September, at the end of September, those applications close out, and we begin our board interview process in the months of October all the way through, sometimes through mid-December. Usually, in normal times, the candidates are notified in February this year. Yes, because of the pandemic and other reasons, we have actually heard from the academies as late as early this month. Next slide, please. So I'd like to go to point number two, and that's candidate preparation. Candidates should do your homework, surf the web, read articles, talk to members, and really know some of those basics. Know the mission, know the honor code, understand or get a feel for the kind of warfare specialties they might want to take, understand the academic programs at each of these academies, and more importantly, probe your understanding of what might be a good fit. We'll talk about this fit issue for you later on. You need to take both the SAT and ACT, and the reason for that is that the protocols for those tests differ. And it differs in the way adults learn. So we can superscore your tests by taking the best of each forward to your final scores. It's important then also you lead community service work and not just participate, but lead. You need to apply for all eligible nominations. You'll see evidence of that when I talk about my results. So not just the congressional nomination, but also the senatorial nomination and any others that you are eligible for. And as you're going on this journey of discovery, you need to ask the question, what's the best fit for you? Because it could very well be ROTC or OCS. Colonel Nelson will be talking about this later. Please, candidates, clean up your social media footprint. Wear business attire, look professional when you come for the interview. It's wise to conduct a practice interview with an adult. Because practice equals confidence, confidence is poise, poise equals credibility. And as you'll see on the next slide, work out, run, and get in shape for that PFT. Next slide, please. You need to be physically fit to serve. This is a shocking statistic, but one that's unfortunately at times a disqualifier for some of our candidates. And you can see as well as I can, 71% of Americans ages 17 to 24, really in the age of service qualifications, do not meet those qualifications due to some type of physical fitness issue. So please get out there and be physically fit if you're seriously considering this candidate. The third and final part of looking under the hood of the process is really those degrees of separation. And we truly are, as the Congresswoman said, looking for those diamonds in the rough. We are looking for the next generation of military leaders. And our candidates in this district are truly, truly outstanding. And the Northern Virginia area is extremely competitive. So just to put a finer point on this, I'd like to highlight a few points that really show those points of separation in a more detailed way. Next slide. Again, I talked about preparedness and passion for service. We have your paper record. What we're looking for you to do is breathe some life into that. So there is a military essay that's involved you'll need to write. We're really looking for that commitment as a way of understanding why you want to serve. We're looking for demonstrated excellence in math, science, and technology, the STEM issues, because the services today are bristling with all of these technologies, and your understanding of those is very important. We often look sometimes at candidate A and B's quality coursework. Are you taking advanced placement courses, and what were your grades? And did you attend summer seminars, leadership classes, sports camps, things that would demonstrate those early essential qualities of leadership? Next slide, please. We talked about this. What's the best fit for you? Is it an academy, or is it a school that offers ROTC or OCS, or going to OCS is one of those choices that you make? In terms of letters of recommendation, we are looking for, again, those essential traits of leadership. And it's not about title dropping. As you are, you know, needing to do when you send in your application, you'll need letters of recommendation. Those letters should speak to your character and give us a reveal of those essential qualities of early leadership. The rigors of time management need to be evident. So how are you able to balance grades, sports, and activities in a way that demonstrates you're able to multitask? And then finally, we talked about really kind of acing the physical fitness test. And then finally, you can ask for the nomination at the end of that process. And in some cases, some candidates have actually reapplied for the next cycle. I've talked about this briefly. This is just a spider chart that really illustrates graphically the kinds of things we look for. But at the top of the chart, honesty, integrity are most important. And so those are the qualities that are bedrock and that we're going to be looking for in each and every one of these interviews. Next slide, please. So as the Congresswoman alluded to, and as I'm happy to report, I'd like to share with you and summarize the Advisory Board 2019 results from our board work last year. Next slide. Let me orient you to this matrix. Down the left-hand side are the logos for the four Federal Service Academies. At the top, Naval Academy at Annapolis, West Point, U.S. Military Academy at West Point, the Coast Guard Academy, and the Merchant Marine Academy. You can see that for three vacancies that the Congresswoman had, we had the wonderful opportunity to place or to nominate in this district 42 candidates. Nine of which came from sources other than the District 10, which of course would be the senator or presidential nominations. And of those 42 nominations, there were 19 offers made across the academies, two for Annapolis, 10 for West Point, four for the Air Force Academy, and three for the Merchant Marine Academy. And again, I talked about the additional nominations, which is one of those reasons why candidates, you need to apply for all eligible nomination sources. So an outstanding year indeed. Hopefully this gives you some view into some of the results. In addition, next slide please. In addition, we were able to make letters of recommendation for those who were not initially nominated, but certainly demonstrated those qualities of early leadership to go perhaps to the prep school. So these letters of recommendation, 12 of them went to the Naval Academy Prep School, three to West Point's Prep School, and three to the Air Force Academy. And we even made one recommendation for the GMU Army ROTC Scholarship Program. Regrettably, the young woman turned down that for another type of program that she was interested in. Again, Colonel Nelson will talk a little about ROTC and the GMU program later. Just to close now, next slide, please. Let me offer you with a personal perspective. For those of you listening, the nomination process is really not about who you know, where you're from, or your socioeconomic station or political affiliation. It's really not. And to put a finer point on it, I've illustrated where I grew up, certainly didn't know anyone in the inner city of Bronx, New York at the time. But thankfully, due to outreach, someone told me about this program. And this is not about who you know. Next slide, please. It's really about chasing your dream toward a selfless drive to serve in what I would like to call the country's best away team. The first place, usually in a world crisis where a phone call is made to say, where are our forces worldwide? I'd like to be part of that team. Next slide, please. So I'll leave you with this thought. The oath of office, again, back to Senator McCain, is a very serious commitment for young people to make. Next slide. And the journey needs to be about your passion to serve. So the candidates out there, to you I say, please own the nomination process. This has to be yours, not your parents. This has to be a process you own. Please do not create self-limitations, and please keep your desire to serve in very sharp focus. With that, I will turn this back over to Anthony and Mr. Barnes.
Thank you very much, Captain Siragusa. I appreciate that excellent presentation. So next we're gonna move on to the service academies. First, representing the United States Naval Academy, we have Commander Martin Fajardo.
All right. So this, can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can, Commander.
All right, just want to make sure. Okay. So this, I'm Commander Martin Fajardo. I'm the Regional Director for the Northeast at the United States Naval Academy. Captain Siragusa, thanks for the great intro. I think you're going to cover a lot of what's in our slides. It'll make going through our slides a little bit easier. Next slide, please. So this is my Region Zero staff, which considers Virginia, Delaware, DC, and Maryland. And I am the counselor also for all Virginia candidates. And that is my email. If you want to email me about anything pertaining to your application, feel free to do so at that email. Next. All right, and your blue and gold officers. I believe Colonel Chitwick is online, who is one of the blue and gold officers in your area, but if not, Captain Zerwonky, his email is on the screen. He is area coordinator for blue and gold officers, which are liaisons to the Naval Academy, which also are an important part of your application because they conduct an interview on you and submit it as part of your application to the Naval Academy. So if once you open up your application and you get your blue and gold officers information, please communicate with them as soon as possible, introduce yourself to them, and start scheduling meetings with them before you do the your real interview. You don't want the only time that you speak to your blue and gold officer to be the real interview. It'll be kind of awkward and probably won't be the best interview that you've had. Next. All right, this is a little bit of stats about the Naval Academy. Everyone likes to brag. This is our bragging slide. Of course, you know, Forbes and U.S. World and News Report, it's different types of data that gets you those standings, but we are the number 24 overall college university in the United States, number 3 public school. What I like to look at is down towards the bottom, the Princeton Review, because that student provided data that gives those rankings. Number 12, most accessible professors, number 4, highest paid grads mid-career. That means 10 years after graduation, Naval Academy grads are the 4th highest paid grads in the country, whether you stay in or get out of the military. So that just goes to say that your education at the Naval Academy will serve you well, whether you decide to stay in or get out, compared to all other universities and colleges in the United States. The most accessible professors, that's I think most in part because we don't have teaching assistants here at the Naval Academy, and all our professors, their main duty is to get you through the academy in 4 years, to get you out to the fleet and lead our sailors and carry on with the mission of the United States Navy. Next. One more, please. All right. These are the 25 majors at the United States Naval Academy. I just want to state our engineering and weapons and math and science track. All the majors listed in those tracks are top 10 in the country compared against anybody. So if you're a STEM focused student, Naval Academy might be your place to go to. Compares against anyone, great education in those. Another thing to mention is that no matter what major that you pick at the United States Naval Academy, it has no bearing on what you select as a career afterwards. Meaning you could be a nuclear engineer and you can go be a pilot. You could go be a surface warfare officer. You can be a SEAL. You could be an EOD officer. You could be cyber. Same thing goes for physics or English. You could be an English major and go be on a submarine as a nuclear officer. So pick your major based on what you like to do, and also because you picked your major as a freshman, and then you'll service select as a senior. So, they're 2.5, 3 years apart, completely different. So they don't correlate to each other. Next. This is what our core curriculum looks like. Blue classes are the Navy leadership classes, would be the exact same classes that you take if you do a Navy ROTC program. Red classes are STEM classes, green classes are humanities classes. If you notice the red, there is a lot of STEM classes on there. Means while you're in high school right now, if you're about to choose your senior classes, make sure that you have physics, chemistry, calculus in there. We like to see at a minimum pre-calc physics and chemistry taken before you graduate high school. Definitely, if you have not taken those classes, I don't think you're prepared to come directly to the Naval Academy. You may need to do prep school at that point. So challenge yourself in high school with a rigorous STEM curriculum, because it's only going to continue when you get here at the Naval Academy. The white spaces you see on that curriculum board is where all your major classes go to. So it's not nap time or free time. It's actually where all your core classes for your major are going to be fit into. Next. A little bit to our, we have a small 8-to-1 student to instructor ratio here. We never go above 25 people per class, so it's very, very small. And like I said before, we don't have teacher assistants. Your professor is your tutor, your instruction. All the extras are done by your professor. So they know your name, and not just because you wear a name tag. They actually have a very close relationship with you. Next slide. If you want to compete in athletics, we are Division I. If you go to NavySports.com, you can find more information about the sport you're interested in, and also information about how to reach out to your coach in the specific sport you're interested in to talk about recruitment. We do have 33 Division I opportunities for students. That's topped only by Stanford and Ohio State. So if you are a Division I caliber athlete, this is a great place where you have an opportunity to play that sport. If you're not Division I, we do have opportunities at the club and intramural levels also. Next. And extracurriculars. Extracurriculars, I think, make you stand out as a high school student, like Captain Siragusa talked about and other people talk about. We look for them in your application. What have you done as a high school student? When you get to the Naval Academy, we don't want you to stop doing that. So right now we have over 100 different extracurricular groups, and they're divided into those 14 different categories that you see on the screen. So chances are, if you belong to a group right now or a special activities group, when you come to a Naval Academy, you will find that group here. Next. So, hey, the slide everyone cares about. Captain Siragusa said it's not all about just coming to the academy. It's not about coming to college for free. It's about service to your country. And at the end of the 4 years, you will be serving your country for a minimum of 5 years. But while you're here at the school, everything is paid for: tuition, room and board, medical, dental, and you get a living stipend that is about $1,150 right now. But you don't see all $1,150. A portion of that is taken away for your daily living expenses, and you end up getting about 100 to 200 freshman year, all the way up to 600 and above your senior year. Next. Then when you graduate, you will go on to serve in the Navy or Marine Corps. About 250 of our students go on to serve in the Marine Corps. The remaining students all serve in, as naval officers and in any capacity, going from surface warfare officers, submarine officers, pilots, special warfare officers, cyber officers, or any other of our designators that we have in the Navy. Next. Basic eligibility. You got to be between 17 and 23, not married, not pregnant, be a citizen by I-Day, and good moral character. These are not waiverable. This is Title 10 that dictates this. So you got to make sure you, at a minimum, have all of these before you start applying. Next. This is our application page. Feel free to go there today. Hit apply now. Start your preliminary application. Once you do your preliminary application, actual applications will go out in mid-May to everyone, so you can start submitting all your documents. Next. All right, these are the 10 documents that it takes to complete your application to the Naval Academy. The ones that I put starts with, I say, are important because when we go to the next slide that talks about medical, you cannot start the medical process until you've submitted 5 documents. Once 5 documents have been submitted, your medical process will begin, and you don't want to delay the medical process. So the 5 items that I have starred are items that I believe you can do quickly enough to get the medical process started. The math and English teacher recommendations, you simply give us the name and email and phone number of your math and English teacher in 11th or 12th grade, and we send them the form to electronically fill out. So that's 2 very simple ones you can get done. Your activities record, you provide us the contact information for your guidance counselor, and we send her a form to fill out electronically. So that's 3 very simple things you can submit to us. Your high school transcript, send that in to us. That's 4 out of 5. Then get your fitness assessment done. It doesn't matter if you don't do super well on the first one. Get the scores to us so you can get, a 5th check in a box. You can continue taking your fitness assessment as many times as it takes to get the score that you want. But getting that first one in gets, one of your 5 documents in to go on to the next step, which is the medical assessment. Next. All right, DOTMERP. So like I said, you got to get 5 items done before DOTMERP starts. DOTMERP has 2 sections. There's a DOTMETS account that you have to create in order to start your testing, to schedule your testing. Then you also have to create a DOTMERP account. DOTMERP account is where you'll track your progress and where you also find out if you passed your test and whether they require any additional documents in order to get you physically qualified, medically qualified. If you're applying for ROTC or any other service academies, this one DOTMERP, one physical exam is all it takes. Just let your guidance counselor or admissions counselor at the other service academies or your ROTC recruiter know, and they will be able to upload your results from the DOTMERP database, so you don't have to take a physical more than once. Next. Nominations, I think these, Captain Siragusa went over them pretty well, so I will go on to the next one. Candidate cycle. So the preliminary application is now open. That is the first step to applying to the class of 2025. In May, we will send out the remainder of the application. That application needs to be completed by 31 January, not a day after. If you don't start your preliminary application now, you have to 31 December to start your preliminary application. Then all candidates are notified of their status by April 15th, and then they decide on whether or not they accept an offer by May the 1st. We start admissions boards at the end of August. So we start accepting people at the end of August here at the Naval Academy. So if you can get your full application into us before the end of August, we do accept highly qualified students beginning the end of August. Next. If you're a highly qualified student, but you are lacking in a math track or maybe need some physical development, there is a chance that the admissions board will recommend you to go to the prep school. The prep school, we have two different tracks for it. One is the Naval Academy Prep School in Newport, Rhode Island. It is a completely free school. We select between 230 and 250 students to go there. If you complete the curriculum there, the 8-month curriculum at the Naval Academy Prep School, you will be made an offer to the Naval Academy for the next year. The foundation program is very similar to the prep school, except that it's not 100% free. It is a needs-based scholarship at one of 16 civilian military prep schools across the country that work with the Naval Academy Foundation. If you're selected for a foundation scholarship, one of our representatives will call you, discuss the options with you, and if accepted, you will complete the 8 months of instruction there. And if you successfully pass it and our board requalifies you again, you will be offered a seat in the next class at the Naval Academy. Next. So to close this out, why come to the Naval Academy? Full scholarship is number one, guaranteed employment. You're gonna have a job when you graduate for the next 5 years at a minimum. A lot of college graduates can't say that right now. You'll have a fun job. Location is Naval Academy. It's located in Annapolis, easy to get to, major airports in DC and Baltimore, so family can come visit you. You guys are local, so it's fairly easy for you guys to get here. Also, internships in grad school. A large number of our students partake in internships in grad school in all the local areas, all the major three-letter agencies, and big DOD contractors, Halliburton, Raytheon, Northrop Grumman. They're all around us. So our students take part in those internships and they're fairly easy for them to get to. Then our graduation rate, 89% on the average. This last class was 91.6, the highest ever for any educational institution in America. We like to brag about that. That means when you get here, you will graduate in 4 years and a high number of you guys will graduate. And that will be all, sir.
Thank you very much, Commander. I appreciate your time.
No problem.
Next up, representing the United States Military Academy at West Point, we have Captain Lucas Dahl.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm Captain Lucas Dahl. I'm the Southeast Regional Commander for Admissions for West Point, which means I cover every state from Maryland down to Florida. And I get the opportunity to work with thousands of candidates in that area, which is honestly, it's a true blessing for me. Next slide, please. A little bit about my background first, just so y'all understand where I'm coming from as I kind of go through all this with you. I took what I like to call the scenic route to West Point. I actually enlisted in the Army prior to coming to West Point. I served 2 years as an enlisted soldier and was accepted as a member of the class of 2010. I actually got to West Point at 22 years old, a week before I turned 23. So I just made the age cut when I came to West Point as well. So I like to think of myself as the perfect example for any candidate who maybe doesn't get an opportunity, doesn't get an offer the first time that they try, or even the second time that they try. I'm the perfect example of if you keep trying, if you want it bad enough that you can get here. Throughout my career, I've served as an ordnance officer and now as a logistics officer. I've had the opportunity to serve in Hawaii, Florida, overseas twice in Afghanistan and Qatar. And I've had great opportunities throughout my career. Next slide, please. West Point is the preeminent leadership development institution in the world. Our leaders have gone on to be senior leaders in the United States military, presidents, CEOs of corporations. Our leaders have gone on to do great things in whatever field they choose to go into after their service time. West Point was actually founded in 1802. I like to point out that what you see in this picture is really the reason that West Point was selected prior to its use as United States Military Academy. It was used during the Revolutionary War. And it was selected based on the river, the Hudson River going up next to West Point here. It's the sharpest bend in the Hudson River. It gave George Washington and American revolutionaries the opportunity to stop any British ships trying to come up the river. Next slide, please. Mission of West Point is to educate, train, and inspire the Corps of Cadets so that each graduate is a commissioned leader of character, committed to the values of duty, honor, country, and prepared for a career of professional excellence and service to the nation as an officer in the United States Army. I always highlight this last line, service to the nation as an officer in the United States Army, because that's what it's all about. You, if you make the choice to go to West Point or any of the service academies, you must understand that service is a part of that. Next slide. We create these leaders of character at West Point through four developmental pillars: academic, military, physical, and character building. Next slide, please. First thing I like to highlight is our academic pillar. We're regularly ranked as one of the top institutions in the United States. As you can see, we have the fifth most Rhodes Scholars all time and the seventh most Marshall Scholars all time. But the ranking that I think is worth highlighting the most is that number one most accessible professors. And I can tell you from my personal experience that this is 100% true. Our instructors were willing to help late at night, early in the morning, after duty hours, on the weekends. They were always accessible, always willing to help. And most importantly, they made sure that we learned the fundamental lessons that we needed to do. For me specifically, in classes like chemistry, physics, calculus, I struggled quite a bit because I had not seen classes like that for 4 years before I had arrived at West Point. And so my background in those STEM classes was pretty small. My instructors were always willing to help me. They'd pick up the phone late at night when I was trying to finish homeworks, when I'd wait till the last minute. They always made sure that I had everything I needed to ensure my opportunity for success. Next slide, please. This is a list of our 38 academic majors. You can see it's a very broad range of STEM majors as well as liberal arts. All of our cadets graduate with a Bachelor of Science degree. And part of that is that even if you choose a liberal arts major, you will take at least three classes in engineering. It's what we call an engineering track at West Point. Next slide. Next, I'm going to talk about our military development pillar. What I really want to talk about here is how we develop our leaders at West Point. And that starts in that six-week cadet basic training, or BEAST, as we call it. This is where we're going to do the basic things to turn a civilian into a soldier. We're going to teach marksmanship, basic first aid, physical fitness, all those basic things that a soldier needs to know. But the most important thing you're going to learn during cadet basic training is how to be a member of a team. Because before you can be a good leader, you need to learn to be a good member of a team. We're going to build upon this when we go into our four-week cadet field training your second summer. Here you're going to do more advanced military operations, such as advanced marksmanship, mounted operations, urban operations. And this is really going to be that first opportunity that you get as a cadet to lead and see what kind of leader you want to be, what works, what doesn't, and figure out, get experience as a leader to figure out how you're going to be as a young officer. Next slide. We continue to build upon this during your junior and senior years with your training detail, which is your opportunity to lead cadets either during cadet basic training or cadet field training. You'll also get an opportunity to do cadet troop leader training, which is basically a three-week internship out in the Army. You get an opportunity to go to the branch of the Army, whether that's infantry, armor, military, intelligence, cyber, whatever you want to do, you're generally going to get an opportunity to go to that branch, to a base in the United States Army, and shadow a second lieutenant and see what is it going to actually be like when I'm an officer. Final thing I like to highlight here is the opportunities that our cadets get for military leadership schools. This past summer, we sent over 500 cadets to airborne school. We brought a mobile training team up here for air assault school and trained over 700 cadets right here at West Point last summer. Cadets regularly get opportunities to go to sapper leader course. They get opportunities to go to special forces assessment and selection. Some of these opportunities that our cadets get are better than what we're sometimes getting in the Army. I can tell you from my experience, I spent a year in an airborne unit before they were able to get me a slot into airborne school. At that time, while I was sitting there waiting for that airborne slot, I was really wishing I had taken advantage of some of the opportunities that West Point had given me when I was a cadet and maybe taken a little bit less leave in my summers. Next slide, please. Our physical development pillar was probably my least favorite as a cadet. But what I'll tell you is I probably learned some of my greatest lessons from the physical development piece, specifically in survival swimming class. When I was a cadet, that class was actually done during our plebe year, and we called it plebe drowning. For me in particular, that was a very good assessment of the class. I'll tell you in advance, I'm not a fan of water, and I really don't like heights. On day one of our survival swimming class, they told us that one of the graduation requirements at West Point is that every cadet goes off of the 10-meter tower and into the water. I looked up at that tower, and I said, there's absolutely no way I can do this. But I still got up every day. I still went to that survival swimming class every day, and I built up my confidence. I built up my abilities within the water, made me understand that I could do what I needed to do. More than anything else, that survival swimming class taught me how to push myself past what I thought my limits were. It taught me how to not let what was going on up here in my brain stop me from doing what I needed to do. I still have fear of heights, still have fear of water, but I know that whatever obstacles are put in front of me, that I can always accomplish those. And a big part of that was a survival swimming class. I can tell you for a fact that there is absolutely no way I would have ever been able to take a step out of an airplane in flight if I had never been able to take that step off that 10-meter tower in my survival swimming class. Next slide, please. The other piece of our physical development pillar is that every cadet is an athlete, whether that's at the Division I level, club sports, or intramurals, our company athletics teams. Every cadet competes. And that's the important word there, is that we're teaching every cadet to compete to win every single day. Because in the United States Army, that's what we do, is win. Next slide, please. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about the path to appointment. I'm going to highlight the things that are special for West Point, because a lot of this process throughout all the academies is much the same. Whether that's the nominations or the medical process, a lot of that is the same. So I'm going to really highlight what's different about West Point. Next slide, please. I always say that this is probably the most important slide that I brief in my slide deck. And I say that because if you want to come to West Point, if you want to be a cadet at West Point and a future Army officer, these are the things you need to know to make yourself the most competitive for an offer of admission. You'll see that 60% of what we look at in our cadets or in our candidates is academics, specifically your high school GPA and your SAT and or your ACT scores. As was said earlier, I highly, highly recommend that you choose to take both the SAT and the ACT. I say this because unless you take both, you're not sure which one is going to give you a better score, which one may just be simpler for you to take. If you take them both, you can see which one seems to work better for you and then potentially focus on that one going forward. Because we do super score what we receive from you. Within the SAT or within the ACT, we super score. No matter how many times you take it, we're going to look at the best scores in each individual section on the ACT or on the SAT. Now, in order for us to do that, in order for us to consider SAT scores or ACT scores, you need to take the SAT with SA at least once, or if you want us to consider ACT scores, take the ACT with writing at least once. Going on to our leadership, we look at 30% of what we look at is leadership. And that's particularly your extracurricular activities and your athletic participation. I always tell candidates, for extracurriculars, think quality over quantity. Anybody can go be a member of 20 different teams and be just that, a member. We're looking for our candidates to step up into those leadership roles and show us their potential for leadership in the Army. The other thing that we look at on the leadership side is school official evaluations. Every candidate is required to submit 4 school official evaluations, one of those from math, one from English, one from physics or chemistry, and one from a physical education teacher. Now, I'll tell you, as for the candidates, this is an opportunity to really have some say in what is said about you within your application to West Point. You're going to take 4 years of English. You're going to take 4 years of math. So pick those instructors that know you the best, that can write the strongest school official evaluation for you. These are basically letters of recommendation just done on West Point standard form and by those instructors that we ask for them to be completed by. The final piece is the candidate fitness assessment. Now, the real big differences here is, well, every service academy does require the candidate fitness assessment. West Point does have minimums that we require our candidates to reach on each of the events, as well as a minimum overall score that candidates have to reach. Now, we don't release those minimums because, to be completely honest, at West Point, we're not looking for the minimum. We always tell candidates, try to reach the averages that are published or even the maximums that are published, and you'll be competitive that way. As long as you can try to reach those averages or better, you're going to be competitive. The final thing I want to point out about the candidate fitness assessment is that we do require video submission for the pull-ups or the push-ups. So if you take your candidate fitness assessment for one of the other academies, submission to one of the other academies, we can utilize that score, but we need those pull-ups and push-ups videos as well. And this is just so that we can verify the correct form is done on those exercises so that we're setting the candidate up for success. You're going to be expected to be able to perform push-ups and pull-ups correctly when you show up for our day. And this is our opportunity to set our candidates up for success and make sure they come ready to perform those. Next slide, please. Final thing I forgot to mention at the bottom of that slide is our application deadline is January 31st. Now, typically we open our applications around early August each summer. With the cancellation of summer leader experience, we are in consideration of opening our second step kit or our full application earlier this year, potentially early July or maybe even in June. This, in my opinion, is probably the second most important slide in the entire slide deck that I have. And that's because it's really, really important that a candidate makes the right choice for them. Don't choose to go to West Point because your parent was a West Point grad. Don't choose because one of your teachers is a West Point grad or an Army, former Army officer that may be pushing you that way. This choice needs to be the candidate's choice. The best way to figure out what is the best fit for me, where is the place I'm going to feel most comfortable and be most successful, is to do a visit. Now, obviously, with everything going on with COVID-19, we're not able to do visits at this time, but I would highly recommend when visits hopefully open back up in the fall that any candidate that's considering West Point comes up for a visit, specifically during the academic year, so that they have the opportunity to interact with cadets during the day, see what cadet life is all about. You actually get to go to class with our cadets. You get to go to lunch with our cadets. You get to see what the barracks are like, what the athletic facilities are like, what the classrooms are like. This is your best opportunity to figure out, hey, is West Point the right place for me? Because it's incredibly important that you make that decision and make that right choice for you. Next slide. This just kind of wraps up all the important information I touched on here. That application deadline, as I said, January 31st. Our medical qualification deadline, we need all candidates, whether that's a waiver approved or just qualified through DODMIRB, we need them to be approved by April 15th. And the accept or decline deadline is 1 May. Any candidates that are not do not make a decision by that date will have a decision made for them. Be proactive throughout the process. Reach out to myself if you have an open application already. If you open an application for our summer leader experience, go in there. You can find under the liaisons link, you can find your local field force representatives. Reach out to them early. Don't wait until they reach out to you for an interview. Reach out to them and start that communication. Apply for all those nominations that you're eligible for. Everybody should be eligible for at least 4. And if you're eligible for service-connected nominations as well, make sure you're applying for all of them. Take this time when you're not in class, when you don't have athletics coming up over the summer, to train for the CFA. If you don't train for it, if you don't practice for it, I can almost guarantee you that you're going to have a difficult time doing well the first time you take it. You need to prep for the candidate fitness assessment and also take advantage of this time. I know you all can't take the SAT or ACT right now, but take advantage of prep classes that are out there and everything that you can do to prepare yourself so that when those opportunities come in the fall to take the SAT and ACT again, that you're ready. You can go in and do your best on those tests. And finally, communicate with me, communicate with the field force. The best way for us to know how much a candidate wants to be at West Point, how competitive they can be, is for them to have open lines of communication with myself and the field force. Next slide, please. This is where everybody wants to get to. This was the best day of my life. I can tell you at that time when I graduated on May 22nd of 2010, it was the best day of my life. Now, since then, I've gotten married, I've had a daughter, and if I didn't say that those were better, my wife would probably slap me, so I have to say that. But from a career-fulfilling standpoint, what I felt I accomplished to get to this point, to be able to throw my hat in the air, was probably the best day of my career. Next slide, please. That wasn't until I got the opportunity to lead soldiers in Afghanistan. I led a transportation platoon running convoys every single day through southern Afghanistan. And the most fulfilling day of my career, and I don't know that any day will ever top this for the rest of my career, was the day that me and all 45 of my soldiers in that picture came home from Afghanistan. And I truly do think that the lessons, the things I learned, the things I gained in my 4 years at West Point had a significant, had a lot to do with my ability to lead that those soldiers well. Next slide, please. Please make sure to look for us on social media, on Facebook, Instagram, all those. Anybody that wants to hear me talk again, if you're not sick of my voice yet, I will also be on Facebook Live tonight. We are doing Facebook Live AIM briefs since we're not able to travel and get out and meet you all. We're doing those 7:30 p.m. Like the West Point Admissions website, and I'll be on there tonight. I'll give a much broader view of everything about West Point.
Thank you very much, Captain Dahl. I appreciate your time. Next up, from the United States Air Force Academy, we have Second Lieutenant Kathleen Kohler.
Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. I'm Lieutenant Kathleen Kohler, and I am a 2019 graduate of the Air Force Academy. Right now, my current role is as an admissions advisor for the Air Force Academy. So for this first year, I help students who are interested in looking at the academy, as well as current applicants. However, my regular job in the Air Force is as a logistics officer. Currently, I am at Shaw Air Force Base in Sumter, South Carolina, but I cover the Northeast as well. And after this, my next assignment, I'll be going to Ramstein Air Base in Germany, and so I'm super excited about that. I'm originally from St. Louis, Missouri, and I've lived there my whole life. I did not have any parents in the military, and I actually found out about the academy pretty late in the game. I hadn't even heard of what junior ROTC was, to give you an idea of how clueless I was about the military in general. While I was a high school student, I was a good student, taking a lot of honors and AP courses, but I wasn't necessarily interested in STEM. I also wasn't a varsity athlete. Instead, I focus much more on theater and speech and debate. And so from the outside, I think most people would have never thought I would go to a military service academy. And I bring this up just to mention that, of course, it helps if you are a varsity athlete. It helps if you have a background in STEM. But for the Air Force Academy, it's not mandatory. Those are not requirements. What matters is diversity of experience. You can be physically fit without being a varsity athlete. You can still be good at math and science, even if it isn't what you chose to take in all of your courses. I will say I did wish I had more background in math, and I think I would highly recommend anyone to continue to take STEM classes to prepare yourself, but just emphasizing that it's not a deal breaker necessarily. Next slide, please. These are photos of me at the Air Force Academy. And so these are all from my senior year. And all of these represent various different culminating events for me. In the very middle slide, if you see the little person right in front of the guidon with the flag, that person up front, that is me leading my cadet squadron when I was squadron commander in formation. And if you look around the slide, it's various different events. The bottom right-hand corner, we're actually in Ireland, and this was for a debate competition. I actually was on the forensics team at the Air Force Academy, and we did compete internationally. In addition, I was in various other clubs and activities, including our theater program, which I was the president of, as well as Steel Script, which is our poetry troupe collective, and the Schulte Assembly, which is a women's affinity group at the Air Force Academy. The other photos show different events. The top right is for Halloween, when we're all in Mitchell Hall. The one with the cadets in the tree is one of our training events. The picture in the bottom middle is actually for a training event that I was able to set up for my squadron. This wasn't something that was mandatory. This was something that we were able to put together as cadets. The bottom left is just after commissioning, when I was officially commissioned as an Air Force second lieutenant. And the photo just above that, we are wearing our gold class colored caps that we wore during basic cadet training. And the people with the red hats that you see, those are the freshmen. And so it's a culminating event when you have, when after you complete recognition, after the freshmen complete recognition, everyone runs to the rock together. And so you remember doing this when you just completed recognition, and now you're on the other side of it. And so it's a pretty awesome experience. The photo with all of us in those blue tank tops is also from recognition, which is essentially an event that happens in March of your dual year, your freshman year, for it's pretty much a transition going into becoming officially an upperclassman when you're recognized as an upperclassman. It is a very physically intense event, say the least. Next slide, please.
Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. But baby, I've been praying hard. Said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Yeah, we'll be counting stars. Like a swinging vine, swing my heart across the line. In my face is flashing signs. Seek it out and ye shall find. Old, but I'm not that old. Young, but I'm not that bold. And I don't think the world is sold. I'm just doing what we're told. I feel something so right, doing the wrong thing. And I feel something so wrong, doing the right thing. I could lie, could lie, could lie. Everything that kills me makes me feel alive. Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. Baby, I've been praying hard. Said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars. Lately, I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. Baby, I've been playing hard. Sitting on the counting dollars, we'll be counting stars.
So that was a quick video of our different airmanship programs at the Air Force Academy. Our airmanship programs are probably my favorite activity that you can participate at the Academy, and it is what makes us very different from the other service academies. And so to quickly go over what you just saw, those skinny little planes, those are called gliders. They're engineless aircraft. And during your freshman year, you're automatically signed up for our soaring program, where you get 5 flights. The last flight is an acrobatic flight, so you will get to do all those cool twists and turns with an instructor pilot who is also a cadet, likely in their junior or senior year. You also saw images of our jump program, our skydiving program, which is actually the only place in the world where your first jump is completely by yourself. So that's not tandem like you can do in the civilian world, and it's not what the Army does, which is static line, where you jump out and the line pulls the chute for you. This is, no kidding, 8 to 10 seconds of free fall and you pull your own chute. Really awesome opportunity. That's what these wings are. It was a really, really crazy experience, and I'm so lucky I was able to participate in that program. Additionally, we also have our powered flight program. So if you're interested in being a pilot, you can sign up for this program, and tons of cadets do it every year. I was also able to participate in this program. And what it is you get about 10 to 15 flights in a small aircraft with a military pilot who's in the Air Force. And if you're doing good in the program, you can actually get to solo by the end. So very awesome experience if you'd like to figure out if you want to be a pilot. I did decide not to be a pilot, so it's not a requirement or something like that. If you participate in the program, you don't have to necessarily be a pilot. It's to help you figure out if you're interested in being a pilot. We also have our cyber program that participates in various different cyber competition teams. In addition to our remotely piloted aircraft program, where we fly military grade 3-foot by 4-foot RPAs that you can actually get certified on. And we also have our space program, where we actually just launched our own satellite into space last year. So that's pretty exciting, and cadets are still pulling data from that. Thank you. And so, just like the other service academies, we're all ranked extremely high. You're not gonna go wrong academically, no matter which service academy you select. It just depends on what magazine you look at, as our rankings are virtually the same, all top tier universities for sure. And so with that as well, we also have an 8-to-1 student to teacher ratio, and we have 27 different majors as well, 28 depending if you count a couple of the other ones. At the Air Force Academy, I was a humanities major, and that is actually not on the list because there's so few of us who are humanities majors. We also are known for our opportunities to do cadet research. And so this is a huge plus to attending a military service academy, and I can speak specifically about the Air Force Academy's research opportunities. So we have 3 different wind tunnels at the Air Force Academy, which is awesome if you're looking at being an aeronautical engineer. We also have a ton of other opportunities. I was originally a legal studies major, and so we also have these mock courtrooms, which are really neat, that we have access to. And additionally, the Air Force values giving cadets the opportunity to do undergraduate research. And this is very different than other universities, especially if you're looking at programs without ROTC programs. And so in this way, if you want to research, you are able to do that at the Air Force Academy. And this is awesome because you're not competing for lab space or lab time like you would at a regular university. You don't have to fight, you know, PhD candidates or PhDs or other graduate students. All of the resources are for cadets. It's not just faculty necessarily doing research. It is all focused on cadets. And so you also have opportunities to do research over the summer, not just during the school year. And this is just a huge opportunity for cadets as well. At the Air Force Academy, we also have a ton of different athletic programs. We have 10 women's Division I sports, as well as 17 men's Division I sports. I was not a Division I athlete, nor did I want to be, but we have a ton of other club sports. And so the photo on the right-hand side just gives images of a few of them. And what's awesome for our club sports teams, you can join a team that you don't have any experience with. For many of our teams, including things like men and women's rugby or our lacrosse teams, people join having absolutely no experience. So it's a great opportunity to pick up an activity that you always wanted to try. Maybe you want to see if you're any good at archery or try the triathlon team, for instance. And so awesome opportunities for you to try other athletic activities. And the academy experience is sort of summarized in how we do our military training with our airmanship programs. So most of our airmanship programs do occur during the summer, but it is possible that you can still do them during the school year, especially if you are training to become an instructor for one of those programs. as well, our military training has several, there are several different mandatory requirements. So after you complete basic cadet training, which is 6 weeks, which happens just before you enter the academy, you will also be participating in an airmanship program of your choosing for one of your blocks during summer, which is optional. You don't have to necessarily do an airmanship program, but most people choose to. You can instead choose to take a class. We also have our survival and evasion course, which is mandatory to take. We also have a program called Operational Air Force, which is sort of like an internship in the Air Force, where you get to follow around different careers and really get a taste of the jobs at the Air Force Academy. You don't actually have to select your job at the Air Force Academy until the end of your junior year, so you do have time to figure out what it is that you want to do. We also have other programs, and once you're an upperclass cadet, you have a bit more freedom with what you want to do in your summers. You will be an instructor for some of those programs. You could be an instructor for our jump program or an instructor for basic training your junior or senior year, but you also can do different cultural immersion and language opportunities. At the Air Force Academy, I was lucky enough to participate in several of these opportunities, specifically going to Poland to study the Holocaust, as well as going to Cambodia and Thailand to teach English. And I also was able to study the playwright Samuel Beckett's manuscripts at the University of Reading just outside of London. I will say I did get to travel more than the average cadet, but it was my experience. And these were opportunities that I was able to seek out. And all of the service academies offer these sorts of opportunities. When I was looking at the academies, I didn't realize the amount of opportunities that were available to me. Next slide, please. Upon graduation of the Air Force Academy, you will serve for 5 years active duty. Of the 989 students who graduated in my class, 450 of them went directly to pilot training. Let me just say that again, 450 went directly to pilot training. That is an awesome, awesome opportunity for any of you who are interested in flight. As well, we actually just this year for the class of 2020, 86 students commissioned into your United States Space Force. So if you are interested in going into the Space Force, the Air Force Academy is the route to go. Similar to the Naval Academy, where if you want to be a Marine, you still go to the Naval Academy. That's sort of how it works with the Air Force Academy and the Space Force. Additionally, there are so many benefits to attending a military service academy, but I really think it came down to two reasons why I loved the Air Force Academy. The first, it was really challenging. It was really, really challenging. And you sign up for the challenge, right? It's gonna be hard, but I didn't realize how much I would grow from this opportunity. But I think the best part of it was all the friends that I made. You will become so close with the people that you went through basic training with the people and the friends you make during your senior year. Attending any service academy is such an honor and such an experience. And now I have the pleasure and the honor to go out and serve with all of these great friends that I made. And I haven't even been an officer for a year yet, so I don't have a ton of experience, but I am so excited for my career in the Air Force. And you won't go wrong no matter what option you select. Any academy, or if you choose to do ROTC, or perhaps go to a military college, I guarantee you, you will not regret choosing to serve, and you will be so happy that you made that decision. Next slide, please. Here you can see our website, academyadmissions.com. We also have information listed at usafa.edu. I'm gonna answer a couple quick questions about COVID-19 and how that's affecting our admissions process. So our summer seminar program has been canceled. As well, we're still standing by to figure out what's going on with basic cadet training. I know that there's a lot of questions about SAT and ACT scores. Currently, you still need an ACT, SAT, pre-ACT, or pre-SAT score to open our pre-candidate questionnaire. That is still a requirement. I understand for some students, this might mean they can't open this questionnaire. That is the situation at this time. You can go to our website to view consistent updates about COVID-19 crisis. Otherwise, we're still going on as usual, still continue to apply. If you do have any questions or issues, you can go to, and not just for COVID-19, but for anything, you can go to our website and click contact us, and you will get a quick response for whatever your questions are for anything regarding the Air Force Academy. As well, our application opened up March 1st. So if you're a junior, you are able to start applying, and it closes January 31st. Our summer seminar applications open up December 1st of your junior year and close out January 15th. This is a little shorter of a window than the other service academies, and our summer seminar is not a pre-screener for our admissions process. So you won't have to worry about that if that is something that you were wondering. But overall, if you have any questions, please go to the contact us information where you will get an answer. Thank you so much for listening to my presentation, and I hope you pursue one of these fantastic opportunities.
Thank you very much, Lieutenant Kohler. Next up, from the United States Merchant Marine Academy, we have Dan Turssini, who's also a member of our Service Academy Advisory Board. So, whenever you're ready, sir.
Thank you very much, Anthony, and thank you, Congresswoman Wexton, for hosting this event. I'd like to speak specifically to the potential candidates out there. As you've heard time and time again this morning, this is your journey. So pay very close attention. I am a 1981 graduate of the United States Merchant Marine Academy, very proud of that. And we didn't have all these resources back in the 70s and the 80s. It was more of, as Captain Siragusa said, reaching out to counselors and stuff like that. And it was a lot of work and on a typewriter to get a lot of this information to the academies and interview with the congresspersons and their folks. So let's go on with the academy briefing. Next slide. So this is our beautiful campus up in Kings Point, New York. It's on Long Island, on the Nassau County's Queens border, on the Long Island Sound. It's the former mansion of a summer mansion for the Chrysler estate. Beautiful campus, and greatly located, a short train ride from Manhattan. Next slide, please. So we are a maritime nation, and we take that for granted. We are, at the Merchant Marine Academy, a service academy. We are not a military academy per se, but we do get a lot of support and funding from both the Army and the Navy through TRANSCOM. We're an important part of the supply chain within the United States, not only the military supply chain, but our regular supply chain. So we like to think of ourselves as an adjunct or a nationwide service academy, and we service everybody, all our citizens, on a daily basis, in time and in war, and very important. We educate and graduate leaders with exemplary character, and we aspire to serve the national security, specifically in marine transportation and economics, and our economic needs. We are all basically engineers. Most of your plebe year, you're gonna learn about engineering. So as you heard with all of the academies, work hard on your higher math and physics, and take as many of those AP classes as you can, and make your time at the academy as fruitful as possible. Next slide, please. We have some history, even though we are the baby of the academies, if you will. We were dedicated in 43 by Franklin Delano Roosevelt. We hold the only battle standard for the federal academies. We've lost 142 midshipmen during World War II that were out at sea servicing our men at war and providing the necessary ammunition, supplies, food, and everything across the world. And then in 1974, we were the first academy to enroll female students. I was lucky enough to be a plebe during the graduation of these fine women, all very successful, all very great leaders in the industry and across the nation. So we're very proud to have that that distinction. And down in the left-hand corner, you'll notice our motto, Acta Non Verba. We are midshipmen and graduates of action. We do. A lot less talk, a lot more doing. Our midshipmen were on the ground in Manhattan during 9/11. We were on the ground in New York and New Jersey during the flood and the disaster hurricanes in New York. We were, our graduates were bringing our ships into port, New Orleans, after their disaster, making makeshift hospitals and food centers, and servicing our country in many different ways. Next slide, please. So what do we do? We maintain the supply chain around the world. We manage, we run, we keep the engines going and the lights on for all the merchant ships with American flags. We provide transportation both in the commercial and the military environment. A big part of our maritime industry is the military sealift command under the Navy program. And in time of war, even I at my age may be called up to pull out some of our old ships sitting in the Jamestown River that may need deployment to help our men at war, women at war, get supplies, etc. Next slide. We serve various industries from shipping to engineering and naval architecture, tug and barge. So our maritime industry is not only the blue waters, it's also the brown waters, the Great Lakes, the rivers, the Mississippi. It's a very rewarding and very widespread capability. Next slide, please. So what do we earn? When you graduate from the academy, you get a Bachelor of Science degree. As not unlike the other academies, we don't have a lot of majors. We're all focused on marine engineering, naval architecture, and the transportation management. Everybody at a minimum gets a commission as an ensign in the Naval Reserve. However, one of the unique things about the Merchant Marine Academy is you can commission into any armed services. I go to almost every graduation now, and I watch the individual midshipmen take commissions in the Air Force, the Navy, Marine Corps, Coast Guard, and the Army. It's a very beautiful sight. While our all midshipmen band plays the music from each of the services while the midshipmen stand and take the oath of office. And then everybody gets a Coast Guard license. That license is either as an engineering officer on a merchant vessel, any tonnage, and either as a deck officer to drive the ship, as well as a third assistant officer to run the engine room of the ship. Next slide, please. Commitment, 5 years in the maritime industry, maintain your Coast Guard license for at least 6 years, and then serve in the Naval Reserve for 8 years. Myself, I was a Naval Reserve officer for 10 years. I was an engineering duty officer in the Naval Reserve, ship repair officer. I mobilized a couple of times into shipyards and other activities, both for the Navy ships and merchant ships. And then you can do duty, as I said, in any military environment, including NOAA, which is a very interesting option for a lot of our midshipmen. Next slide. So these are the assignments that we provided over the last few years into the military. And as you can see, we have graduates going into all the military services as well as the maritime service and NOAA. Next slide. We're on a trimester system, so it's a little bit different than the other academies. Hands-on training is our philosophy. Not only do we have huge engineering laboratories, nautical science laboratories, but sea-year training is key and one of the unique points of our academy. You do spend a year at sea to attain a license. To obtain that Coast Guard license, you must have the requisite time at sea. So you go out, and it's not a training ship. You go out with commercial vessels, in some cases foreign flag, where we have friendly relationships, but in most cases, American flag ships. And I want to tell you that is the greatest experience I ever had. You spend 6 months of the year, roughly, in your sophomore year, about 6 months in your junior year. Can be broken up a little bit differently. But you're out there, and you'll see another slide, but the world is our classroom. We learn by the professionals, and we learn on actual vessels and in actual situations. As a midshipman, as a cadet, my second class year, on one of my ships, we lost our second mate. Why is not important, but he was not able to make the ship. And I was given responsibility to stand watch, and I was a deck cadet on that particular ship. I had the third assistant, the third mate's watch the whole trip back from the Mediterranean. I say I was a deck cadet on that. Back in the 80s, in the 70s and 80s, there was a program for getting two licenses. So I was a dual major at the academy, received two licenses as an engineer and as a mate. And again, the time at sea was invaluable learning, that both from a leadership perspective and from learning the trade. We also have a training vessel at the academy. Weekends, off time, over the summer, whenever you can, getting on board these vessels and really learning everything there is to know. And a ship really is an ecosystem in itself. Not only do the engines have to run, but the toilets have to flush, the lights have to be on. It's a great experience to be able to manage. It's like managing a city. Next slide. Again, the deck license, mostly marine transportation, marine logistics and security, nautical science. A lot of this has to do with the interface with the naval science. A lot of our marine transportation, maritime logistics is coordinated with the Navy as and other seagoing services. As you know, we provide replenishment ships, not only for fuel, but also for food and supplies. The engineering license is a full marine engineering program. What is marine engineering? It's electromechanical engineering. So you have to understand electrical engineering. We have computer science minors. You have to know mechanical engineering. We have design programs, naval architecture programs as minors. Not only ships design, but all kind of architecture and capabilities there. So if you're going to go and pick King's Point, you want to be very prepared for engineering courses. Next slide. So these are the course snapshots. I'm sure you can read this. These will be posted on, available on the Facebook page that this is being recorded to. Next slide. And the curriculum split, as you can see, you spend times at sea, your third year or your sophomore year, and your second class year or your junior year. So you really cram in 4 years of college into 3 years. So this academy is not for the faint-hearted. We're not D1. We are a D3 school, but we have all the sports available, and everybody is involved with either a club or a D3 sport. I ran track, and I did that two seasons per year. Of course, the C year interferes with that at some point. So when you manage your split and how you're going to do your C years, you want to manage that sometimes around your sport affiliation. But there's plenty of things to do, just like all the academies, and it's very challenging, and especially challenging to get in 3 years of an accredited program, 4 years of an accredited program into a 3 year classroom time. Next slide. And this is just a different split, whether you're an A split or a B split. Next slide. Again, the world is our campus. When I was a cadet, I was all over the world. I spent my third class year in the Med. I did get to Egypt and saw the pyramids and the Sphinx. I was in Tunisia. I was in Cyprus. I went up to the Black Sea, sailed through the Aegean, went around to Greece, Italy, Spain, Portugal. It was a great experience. My second class year, I sailed out of the West Coast. I sailed to the Orient, got to see Japan, Hong Kong, and various places along there. I also got to sail a tanker up to Alaska, Valdez, and saw our great state up in the cold area of Alaska. It was beautiful, and it's an experience you'll never forget. And again, as the other people thought, the friendships and the camaraderie of the academy graduates are unique, and we are unique in that there are only less than 15,000 living graduates. We're a much smaller school. We enter about 250 per year. Students on campus any given year is a little less than 1,000 students. So like any other college choice, a big university or a big academy aren't right for everybody. I think the D3 experience and the smaller academy was definitely right for me, and definitely gave me some huge opportunities. Next slide. Regimental program. We're all sworn into the U.S. Navy Reserve, Merchant Marines Reserve Program as midshipmen. We wear the uniforms at the academy. So we wear the gold band, and we are in the Navy Reserve Merchant Marine Program as midshipmen. So that's why when we go to sea in time of war, our cadets are also in the mix. We develop, of course, fellowship and leadership skills, as do all the academies. Again, if you're interested in service, and not just military service, but all the services available in this great country of ours, this is a wonderful place to learn the skills to be successful and to be meaningful in the service area. We emphasize respect, honor, and service, and courage. It's remember, when you're a merchant mariner, you don't carry a gun, you don't have guns on your ship, you trust our Navy counterparts to protect you. But the maritime industry is in harm's way, even in times of peace. I know you've heard, may have heard of the pirating in the Persian Gulf and other areas, especially an American flag ship is always a prime target for people that want to take advantage of our great country. And then the first classmen, like the other academies, are essentially under the supervision of the academy's common of a midshipman. We exercise the command of the regiment. As a third classman and a second classman, I was a pusher, our term for a drill sergeant for the incoming class. So right out of my plebe year, I was indoctrinating a midshipman that second year, my third class year. And you learn very quickly to be a leader. And the regiment is run by the midshipmen, especially the first classmen who take command of the battalions, the companies, etc. Next slide. Typical day at the academy starts early and ends late. Of course, we always get up early to pay homage and salute our flag. If you're lucky enough, you can be part of the flag raising in the morning during mustering and colors. We do boast that we have the longest freestanding flag in North America, and right in the middle of our beautiful campus, and it's a beautiful sight. And even as a graduate many years later, when I go to the academy, I try to get there early to watch colors. It's a very heartwarming and patriotic thing to watch. Next slide. Our athletic program, again, we're not D1, but we have something to do for everybody. Constantly adding, as you see, we have a new program for women's soccer. And we are very competitive in the D3 community. We actually come down here, our teams come down in the DC area very often. So if you're lonely for family up in the Long Island area, and you play a sport, you might be come down to play Catholic University or one of the other universities in the area that we play. We always our alumni association, which I'm a former president of the local chapter, always has events at those at those sports events, so that we bring the parents and the midshipmen together for refreshments and camaraderie and hugs. That I know a lot of you miss when you're at the academy. Next slide. So our waterfront programs include our capital vessel, which is a training tug, our offshore sailing. I got the privilege to sail on a couple of Ted Turner's American Cub boats when I was there, were stored and parked at the academy. I wasn't a great sailor, but I was good ballast, but it was a lot of fun. We do have a power squadron, keel boats, dinghies, rowing, anything you want on the water. Long Island Sound is a beautiful place to do both sunny day sailing as well as some of the colder days and learning how to be a sailor out in the cold waters. Next slide. Our band. Again, is a fully midshipman band led by our midshipman band leader. It is world renowned, if you will, certainly in the United States. We get to march in the inaugural parades. Not only the band, but one of the battalions gets to march in the parade. I was privileged to march in Ronald Reagan's inauguration in 1981. It was a great experience, but the band does play all over the United States and is what keeps us in cadence as we do our parades on Tomb Field, located at the Academy, pretty much every weekend. So it's a great experience, and it's unique. We don't have the funds to go out and buy a band like the other academies, so so if you play an instrument, this is a great place to be. Next slide. So what do you need? Just like the other academies, pretty much the same, but United States citizen. I guess we got a year older, 24 by July 1st. Good moral character. And again, meet the physical security, stability, character requirements. If you get into any of these academies, I know I did my end of my senior year of high school, during my senior year and the summer before. We start early. We start in very early July at the Merchant Marine Academy. So run, exercise, be ready to go. My friend at West Point mentioned the swimming. I'm not a great swimmer, but one of the things you don't want to be is in remedial swimming at the academy because time is short. So be ready to do all the physical fitness requirements during your indoctrination period. It's well worth being in great shape when you get into any of the academies. Next slide. Again, academic, physical, medical. They talked about the DOD MIRB. And your nomination, either from your representative or a senator. If you're lucky enough, you can escalate that and get a presidential, vice presidential nomination. Look at all areas. There are plenty of places to attain those credentials. Admissions test, there is a typo in the reading for the SAT that is in the 600, 650 range as well. The ACT, again, these are the ranges for the middle 50%. Academics and SATs aren't everything getting into any of the academies, but they are important. So work hard, especially in your math skills. We are focused on engineering at this academy. We don't have a humanities track or something like that. So you will be taking engineering courses, and your math is especially important in this adventure. Next slide. Pretty much the same evaluation. I'm happy to be on the evaluation for Congressman Wexton. I've seen so many great applicants this past year, and we were so lucky to put so many people in the academies. I'm very proud that we put three into Kings Point this year. What's happening this year with the virus is still an unknown, both from the academy perspective and I guess from our evaluation perspective. I do know that our superintendent, Jack Bono, who's a class of 78, is working hard, and I've been speaking with him on and off over the last few months on where we're going and what's happening with the virus. They're still making plans, but we do expect to invite a new class next July. I've also been speaking very often with our maritime administrator, Mark Busby, class of class of 78, or class of 79. I'm sorry. Mark is a retired Navy Rear Admiral, now appointed maritime administrator. Now I guess for 3 years, and those two gentlemen are doing as much as they can to emphasize the need for maritime service and the need for our maritime industry and the Maritime Merchant Marine Academy. Next slide, please. Again, with fitness, same as all the other academies, so I'm not gonna push on this too much, but do the running and do the exercise. Next slide. The medical examination, just like all the other academies, it's going to check that you're in good physical and mental health, weight requirements. Waivers are on a case-by-case basis, but we're a small school and it's very competitive. As I said, we only admit about 250 students each year, so we're looking for the best, and that's physical, mental, and academic. This is an easy part, really, this getting physically fit, and it's all on you. It's not on your parents. The academics, by now, you know where your academic strengths are, so make sure you finish strong and do the best you can. Best thing you can do now is work on your leadership and your presentation. When we interview you for your nomination, your presentation is everything. We see the numbers, we see your letters of recommendation, now we see you, and that's very important. So get comfortable in your skin. Be who you are, don't change who you are, but be comfortable in your skin and show those skills, show that leadership, show that desire to be the next generation of leadership. Next slide. So everybody's eligible for at least three nominations. The nominations again January 31st. As a non-military service academy, you can add us, add Kings Point as your desired school in addition to or with the other military academies. So if you're not sure, and I like to think of Kings Point as the service academy that gives you more choices, not only within the military, but in and out of the military. There are so many different things you can do graduating from Kings Point right out of the academy, while still serving in the Naval Reserve, while still serving in a service environment, whether that be in the designing of naval vessels or becoming a leader at NOAA or any other government agency or even in industry. So it's something that you should think about. We don't have the numbers that the other academies have, but if you're interested in flying, those who want to fly out of Kings Point, either in the Navy or the Air Force, normally get what they're looking for. And so you have a lot more options than just going through one service. And as services are, you do their service based on the needs of the service, not what you need. Next slide. Submit online. Again, all of this is online and available to you. So I suppose most of you have started the submission process. If you haven't, go to our website, go to all the Academy websites and start the process as soon as possible. Next slide. Really not much difference here on the timeline, so I'm going to leave it at that. Next slide. What's the strategy? This is all about you, prospective candidates. Mom and dad can help, but they can't submit this. They can't desire you to go. They can help you. And in many cases, this is all about you, and it's not about who you know and the connections made. It's really about your capabilities, your desire to get in. And I will tell you, there are people that get in some of the academies based on recommendations from some important people. I can tell you as a plebe, my first 2 weeks in my company, not less than three people walked out because they decided this wasn't for them. And in all cases, those were people that we're going because of legacy requirements or legacy desires. If you don't want to go here or any of the academies, you're not going to make it through. So it's got to be on you. It's all about you. The earlier you start, the more you can update your application. Take the SAT, take the ACT more than once. Early. Take chemistry, physics, calculus, take AP if you can. You're not going to transfer the credits, right? You're not going to get the credit necessarily at the academy. But what you are going to do is have a head start on all of the hard courses because the pace is very fast. Complete the physical, visit the academy. You'll fall in love with it. The school is beautiful. It's smaller than some of the other schools, but it is homey. It is a great place to be. Explore all of your options. Look at all of the academies. Look at all the options all of the academies offer you, and even some of the ROTC and other programs. And decide what's right for you. I'm an academy graduate. My third son, who is just graduating med school and is entering his residency in a couple of weeks now, was nominated into the Naval Academy, but decided that that was not the right path for him to become a doctor. And he sat with me and he said, I hope you're not disappointed, Dad. And I said, not at all, because it's got to be his choice. He's got to want to be there. And I was very proud of his decision and also very proud of what he made of himself. Dr. Turssini, very proud. Next slide. Class of 23, this is the average stats that are coming out. You heard a lot of things about the where the standings in each of these schools have. We've always ranked in the top 10 or top five of public schools. We've always ranked in the top five of small schools or regional schools. We have a solid program. We have a great education program, and everybody has a job getting out of the King's Point, out of all of the academies, but getting out of King's Point, whether it's a military position or a service position in the government or a service position in the maritime industry. Everybody has a good job. And in this time and age, you also have a trade. I was able, and most of our engineering and even some of our DEC graduates have capabilities and trade capabilities that are beyond just academics. I learned to weld, I learned to do pipe fitting, I learned a lot of trade things that have held me well. And you know, in this day and age now, where essential workers right now in this crisis are the plumbers and the people that are doing hands-on work. So learn to do more than one thing, and it'll serve you well in your skills as a leader, because when you're leading people that are doing those mechanical skills, doing those trade skills, it's good to know how to do some of those things, and you can be a better leader that way.
Next Dan, and Dan, this is George. In the interest of the two speakers that are coming after, can you wrap this up pretty quick?
Sure will.
Thank you, sir.
Next slide. So again, cadet visits, please visit the academy. Next slide. Next slide. So there's our EDU admissions website. Please visit us. Phone numbers are there as well. If you call Anthony or email Anthony, he will give you my personal contact information. I'm happy to speak to anybody about the academies or King's Point specifically and help you through the process, whatever you need. I'm always looking for bright young people ready to join the United States Merchant Marine Academy. Thank you very much, Anthony. Thank you, Congresswoman Wexton.
Thank you very much, sir. Our next presenter from the United States Coast Guard Academy.
Great. Thank you, Anthony. You got me there?
Good to go, sir.
Awesome. Well, I just want to thank Congresswoman Wexton and her staff, including yourself, for putting on this event in such short notice. It just goes to show much they care about you and our service academies during this time. A little about myself. Next slide, please. So originally from Tampa, Florida, came up to the Coast Guard Academy to study business management. Participated on the cross-country and triathlon teams. I then graduated in 2013, went out to my first assignment down there in Portsmouth, Virginia to serve as a deck watch officer, navigator for one of our law enforcement ships. Got to participate in our law enforcement missions, our humanitarian services and missions that we do, doing counter-drug interdiction, migrant interception and rescuing and repatriation down the Caribbean. I then spent 3 years up in New Haven, Connecticut, helping operate a search and rescue command center, and then this most recent year, helping direct emergency management operations for Long Island and Connecticut. By far, that was probably the most meaningful work I've done here in the past few years, my time of service, just because the amount of fulfillment it brought to me every day. I mean, you come to work, you've got a mission at hand, you've got goals and objectives. The missions are real, the outcomes are real, real responsibilities, certainly daunting at times, given the level of responsibility. You know, the stakes are high, you know, lives are at stake, but ultimately your training, your judgment, your critical thinking, your leadership, that all culminates and dictates the outcome to such cases. Like Captain Dahl said, Our military service provides great fulfillment in our service to the nation. Certainly when you've got the opportunity to save lives, help others, that provides so much significance, and certainly it's going to be probably the most important thing I ever do in my professional career. Now I've come on to serve as an admissions officer for the Coast Guard Academy to continue to contribute to future generations of our leaders. So I'm happy to work with such energetic and talented individuals applying to the service academies, and look forward to helping you through this journey. Next slide, please. A little about the Coast Guard. We're a multi-mission maritime service. Coast Guard is one of the oldest organizations within the federal government. Our history dates back to 1790 by our founder of Alexander Hamilton. We are the world's premier Coast Guard. As maritime guardians, the mission of the Coast Guard is to ensure our nation's safety, security, and stewardship. Our missions have certainly evolved over the century, and our focus on humanitarian helping others certainly remains the same. Our primary focus is our federal law enforcement statutes as an agency and as a military force. We're a protector of the United States during peacetime and time of war. We're often a first responder during times of crisis, and day to day we serve under the Department of Homeland Security, executing our 11 statutory missions. Next slide, please. So this is just kind of a quick glance of our different missions that, again, we're doing day in, day out. We've got just over 100,000 miles of inland and coastline that we protect, 4.5 million square miles of water stretching from north of the Arctic to south of the equator. On average, the Coast Guard conducts dozens of search and rescue cases, seizes thousands of pounds of drugs every day. We're interdicting dozens of illegal aliens and migrants, conducting fishery operations and conservation efforts, investigating pollution incidents. So these were all real cases, real missions that we're doing day in, day out. We certainly just don't come to work to train, waiting for that next big thing to happen. We're an operational workforce, no days the same. Like you turn on the news, you know, you might see a hurricane disaster. Coast Guard's going to be there leading from the forefront, helping provide, you know, a path forward for this nation. So one kind of major difference, obviously, we're being a smaller service. Certainly provides a kind of a more family feel. You're going to be working with the graduates from the service academy, going out into the fleet, working with them throughout much of your career. So, you know, overall, our size is, you know, just about the size of the New York Police Department. Our reality, about 40,000 person active duty force. So certainly smaller than the other services. We're spread out throughout the U.S. and worldwide at different posts. Next slide, please. Quick glance at the academy, very similar to King's Point with as far as class body size, just over 1,000 students. We're situated on the Thames River in New London, Connecticut, 100-acre campus. Kind of see some of the general stats there for SATs and enrollment numbers, 700 math, 650 verbals, the average 50%. We just appointed 40% females for the class of 2024. We look forward to doing that here in the years forward. So. Certainly provide a good diverse class enrollment for throughout all of the U.S. We also have international cadets come in to participate. We don't require congressional nomination. That is the one difference. However, we certainly would welcome a congressional letter of recommendation if you do have one. Another telling sign there is 85% of our workforce stays with us after their five-year commitment. Just goes to show how much people enjoy working for the Coast Guard, the people that are around, the community and the environment and the culture that we have as far as our Coast Guard workforce. Lastly, if you want to go to flight school, those opportunities are certainly there, very similar to that of the other service academies. So if you wanted to go to, you know, fly a helicopter or fixed wing aircraft, all of that is there upon graduation. Your academic major doesn't dictate what career path you're going to go into, very similar to the other service academies, your options and doors remain open. Next slide, please. Do your homework. Obviously, you've heard all of the different service academies rank very well nationally and regionally on their comparative scales. You know, it's important you go out and find the school that's the best fit for you. So if you're looking for a small school environment, Coast Guard Academy, Kings Point, et cetera, the service academies are probably a great fit for you. Again, get on the websites, get on US News, do your homework. Nice thing, again, everybody's got a job after graduation. 85% of our workforce earns a master's degree or PhD. At some point during the career, it's an expectation as an officer of higher education and learning that you're going to continue to develop yourself and pursue additional education. Next slide, please. Get online, do your homework again on academic majors, find out what academic major is the best fit for you. You know, you're really committing to a particular major. We want to see you commit to that for the 4 years. If you need to switch, you can certainly do so. But it's not like a traditional four-year school where you're going to jump around two to three different majors. So definitely spend the time up front to know what you're getting yourself into and what you might want to pursue and do after you graduate. The nice thing is that, again, if you graduate with a government degree, you can still go to flight school. If you graduate with a mechanical engineering degree, you can still be a law enforcement officer. Key things, we're looking for technically minded folks that have an interest and passion in STEM. You know, much of our world's problems now are technically, you know, we need technically driven officers that can solve complex problems. And everybody's going to graduate with a bachelor's degree of science. That's going to aid you in solving those problems. Next slide, please. Very similar to that of the other service academies as far as how we operate and function. It's a four-year program, five-year commitment. Following that, again, very similar with cadet regimental system. You're leading the underclassmen beneath you as you progress through your 4 years. Go to other service academies if you want to see what another one is like. That's all. Next slide, please. Key thing here is that each summer you're going to go out into the fleet and participate in our various missions. So it's a very much hands-on summer. In my case, I went down the Caribbean, got to do kind of drug interdictions as a sophomore in college. So that was pretty amazing, just get out and travel really the world at that point at such a young age. Got to spend a summer up in Alaska doing our aids to navigation missions. We send cadets really worldwide to different units and different ships to get that hands-on experience so that upon graduation, you're going directly to your unit. You're not going to 6 months or a year's worth of training for that next job. You've already done that over your four-year period. We also send people to Coast Guard Cutter Bark Eagle, our only operational sailing ship in the U.S. And so that's an awesome platform to get out to get your first exposure to seagoing service and learn those navigation skills. Likewise, we'll send people to different flight training programs, law enforcement training programs to get that hands-on training. Lastly, there's our Coast Guard internship. So we've got a portfolio of over 100 internships with various top-tier corporations. So if you want to kind of get out of the Coast Guard swim lane and see what Facebook or Google or other companies are doing and bring back some of those things that you've learned, that's always great to do as well. Next slide, please. Health and physical development are certainly core requirements for all cadets. We do a physical fitness exam every semester. That's going to be another requirement for application, very similar to the other service academies. Our exam is slightly different, but overall, the general focus on physical fitness remains the same. Students participate two out of three athletic season. We have 25 collegiate sports at the Division III and Division I levels. 65% of students play a NCAA sport, which is one of the highest percentages in the country at any university. So out of 1,000 or so students, 65% or plus are playing a collegiate sport, which is pretty spectacular. Get on the coaches' radar now, you know, get onto the websites, reach out to the coaches, start that dialogue now so that you've got a line of communication with them over the next year or two. Next slide, please. We've got over 50 different cadet activities. You're going to be involved. It's almost kind of limiting to make sure you don't get too involved. You've got to manage your time. This is where you're going to certainly make friends, get out of your comfort zone. I got involved in several clubs just to get me out and away from the campus when I needed to. So certainly stay involved and find ways to make impact while at the academy. Next slide, please. Very similar to how you're going to experience at any other service academy. You know, it might seem daunting at first, but this is what you're already doing on a day-to-day basis for the most part. You're already getting up early. You're already going to classes. You're already going to sports practice or band practice after your academic day. You're probably staying up late already studying. So it's just getting in that routine, that daily routine. It just becomes a habit after that. Next slide, please. These are the three pillars that we're looking for in competitive applicants. Very similar again to other service academies for what we're looking for in academics. We're looking for AP, IB curriculum, strong GPAs. We're looking for your involvement within your school, your community, what you're doing, maybe you're employed, leadership opportunities that you're partaking in. You know, what's your ability to make a contribution and impact to the Coast Guard Academy, maybe it's through athletics or band or other some form of talent. So find that hook, find that niche that's going to make you unique out of the thousands of applicants. It's going to help you stand apart and be well-rounded. So, you know, don't just be an ace in the hole in just one area. Make sure that you're covering all these bases. Next slide, please. We do have our summer academy introductory mission still planned. That is in July. So for those that did apply, congratulations. Decisions will be out here at the end of next week, May 1st. We'll have a go, no-go decision date on our AIM program come May 15th. Obviously, with COVID-19, everything is still in fluctuation, but our intention is to still continue to move forward with the planning phase and having this event. For those that are maybe sophomores or freshmen, this is a program you want to put on your radar now for juniors going into their senior year. An excellent way to come see the campus, experience it firsthand, take a test ride, so to speak. It's a very involved week, very intense week. It's not like there are Swiss academies we're going to go and maybe do push-ups for an hour. This is a full week of physical and intellectual development and testing. So a great opportunity again to come up and see the campus firsthand and meet with cadets and coaches. Next slide, please. Application will open up August 4th, Coast Guard's birthday. That's going to run, as far as the timelines, very similar to the other service academies, and you've got your various outcomes. We do have prep school options. We do send people to Naval Academy's prep school and two other service academy prep schools. If you don't necessarily make that initial cut for a direct appointment, we're giving out right around 50 appointment slots to prep school next year, and then everybody also reports in for SWAB summer. Next slide, please. Biggest thing here is, you know, to be in the discussion for an admissions decisions, you must apply. Don't get discouraged by the process or how daunting it might be. Work on it, get it in so that you can be part of this discussion. Obviously, everything can be done online. Same thing, letters of recommendations from your teachers, get that on their radar now. We're gonna need to see SAT, ACT score reports. We're gonna be looking for your physical fitness evaluation. We're gonna be looking for your personal statements. Spend time to put a quality application together. There's no prize to be first place here. We're looking for the best you. This should be an application that you're super confident about. So it doesn't matter that you're the first person in or the last person in. We're going to review everybody holistically. The key thing is own your application. This process is up to you, not your parents. We want to see motivated applicants. We want to see applicants that want to be here. That should show through in your application, through your personal statements, through your interactions with admissions officers, through your desire to attend the Coast Guard Academy. So find ways to do that. Do your homework. You're going to probably do an interview. So it needs to show that you've got genuine interest and passion to serve. That you're not just here for personal reasons. Next slide, please. Just a little bit of some photos of some of my personal experience as well at the Coast Guard Academy. Had every opportunity from sailing around to Long Island, to Block Island, to Martha's Vineyard on our sailing platforms down at the waterfront, to going out to different air stations. I spent time in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, at an air station, going out to ships down there. Obviously, plenty of military traditions and balls. Met my wife all at the Coast Guard Academy, again, competed on various teams, and really just got to do a host of different experiences. Next slide, please. Some of my proudest days here, receiving my commission from my grandfather and vice president, getting a sail on Eagle, just getting to really meet some of the best friends of my life. And, you know, those are friends I'm going to continue to be in touch with for many, many years. And really just getting out into the fleet, doing good, both here for my community, for the state, for the nation, and continuing that work. I look forward to doing this for hopefully many more years. So next slide, please. Big thing here is get online, check out the website, create a Bearsden account with us. That's just an online portfolio you can set up with us. That way we get a little bit more to know about you, and you can start to learn more about us. We can start sharing information with one another. If you're a freshman, or sophomore or junior, look at the Bear State program in the fall. That's a one-day program for coming up and making a visit. If you're going to be a senior, look at the Cadet for Day program. That's an overnight program. Key things, you know, finish the academic year here on a strong note, and please reach out to me as your admissions officer if you have any questions. Take down my information there and go Kings Point. Thank you, Anthony.
Thank you very much, Lieutenant Nelson. I appreciate that. Last up, we have Lieutenant Colonel Michael Nelson, representing George Mason University Army ROTC program. Sir.
Thank you, sir, and thank you to everybody, including Congressman Wexton, for inviting me. Wexton, for inviting me to come and participate in this. So we've heard from all the service academies as a route to commissioning. I'm here to speak on behalf of specifically Army ROTC as a route to commissioning within the Army. Full disclosure: the other services do obviously have their own ROTCs. So Air Force ROTC, Navy ROTC, which is a commissioning route for both the Navy and the Marine Corps, and then we have Army ROTC. So the information I'll provide here is pertinent primarily to the Army program. The other programs have their own mechanisms for establishing scholarships and what their requirements are on the road to commissioning. But this will be the Army's specific one. I represent George Mason University. I'm the professor of military science there, which means I run the department. We are Northern Virginia's only Army ROTC program. There are others nearby in Maryland and Central Virginia and DC, but we're the only one in Northern Virginia. And while we are based at George Mason University, as you can see from this slide, we cover the University of Mary Washington, Marymount University, and then as well, initial two-year students from the Northern Virginia Community College that eventually transfer into one of those three schools. A little bit about myself. I've received my commission through Army ROTC, so I am a product of the process that I'm about to describe to you. I was commissioned as a field artillery officer and spent 4 years in the 82nd Airborne Division prior to going to Army Special Forces Assessment Selection and the Special Forces Qualification Course. So I've been a Special Forces officer for the past 15 years, and I've been in the Army 20 years. All right, please, next slide. All right, a couple things we'll talk about. The purpose of orienting you to Army ROTC, pathways to serving as an Army officer, an overview of the Army ROTC process as a whole, not just for scholarships, but the program as a whole, how the scholarship process works and what the other benefits are. And then I'll provide points of contact for anyone who has questions for me in the future. All right, next slide. Okay, so here's our purpose: identify the pathways to becoming an officer, overview of the program, talk about different commissioning sources, explain our scholarships. All right, next slide. Okay, so to become an Army officer, there are four primary routes to do this. You can see at the bottom there, the United States Military Academy, which we heard from Captain Dahl, West Point, how you know, as an appointment to go straight through that route to become an Army officer. Well, we also have Officer Candidate School, which is primarily designed for our already serving enlisted and NCOs who either have a degree or are well on the way to getting close to having a degree. Or in certain circumstances, we also recommend that college graduates who are interested in serving as officers but have not participated in ROTC then seek out an Army recruiter to participate in Officer Candidate School. There's a direct commissioning route, which exists primarily for established professionals, lawyers, doctors, dentists, those key technical and professional skills that we need in the Army that have been produced through a series, you know, years of education and already exist in the civilian world and are interested in serving their country. So, but what we're talking about for this audience, the two routes for high school seniors to get on the path to becoming Army officers are the Military Academy, West Point, and Army ROTC, which is what I'm going to talk about. Next slide. Okay, so Army ROTC is a nationwide program. We are divided into eight different brigades. You can see those are divided regionally and then with First Brigade covering our military schools like the Virginia Military Institute, the Citadel, Texas A&M, et cetera. So we are distributed throughout the country. We have 274 host programs, which means central hubs where the programs are located, like mine, like George Mason University. However, ROTC extends well beyond those 274 schools. You can see we have 678 extension or cross center programs. What that means is if you or your family member is interested in participating in ROTC, but they have a particular college in mind, even if there is not an ROTC department within that college, there is most likely a local program that is that has an established relationship with that college. So, for example, my program at George Mason, students who go to Mary Washington but want to seek an Army commission still come through my program. And if you are applying to schools and don't necessarily see that there's an ROTC department, I recommend calling the admissions department and asking who their associated ROTC program is, because 9 times out of 10, there is coverage for every institution of higher learning within the United States. All right, next slide. All right, you can see our breakdown. So we have over 30,000 cadets within the program, within ROTC as a whole, distributed across the country. Of those, about 1,200, just over 1,200, are on scholarship. Now, most of you are primarily familiar with the idea of applying for what we call the national scholarship process while you're in high school. While you're doing your college admissions, you apply for an ROTC scholarship. You will either be awarded a 4-year scholarship or a 3-year scholarship, or told that you did not receive a scholarship. That's the route that most people think about. However, ROTC also offers what are called campus-based commission or scholarships. So in other words, if your student arrives on campus, does not have a scholarship, participates in Army ROTC, demonstrates high academic standards, represents a high level of involvement with the program and motivation, their program can put them in for a scholarship to be awarded that will cover either 3.5, 3, 2.5, or 2 years, depending on how much academic career they have left. In my program, the majority of my students, the majority of my cadets are on some form of scholarship. The majority of my contracted cadets, which means they have already made the commitment to the Army. Of those, a vast minority showed up with a national-based scholarship. Most of them were campus-based. So if your student is applying for a national scholarship but is not awarded one, that does not necessarily mean that they are out of the fight for a scholarship, so to speak. Additionally, one of the takeaways I'd like to point out on this slide is the diversity of the ROTC program represents the diversity of the country and the diversity of the Army as a whole. We are more representative of minorities and of female cadets than most other commissioning sources. My program in particular, we have far more female cadets and proportionally and far more minority cadets than the Army as a whole. So there are a lot of different pathways depending on your students' interests, backgrounds, et cetera, to seek a commission through ROTC. All right, next slide. All right, so the scholarships. One takeaway I want to point out there right at the top. Army ROTC is the single largest provider of scholarships in the United States, and it's not even close. Once again, I talked about the other services having their scholarships. The Army blows them away. Sorry, other services, but it's true. So we provide the majority of scholarship money that goes to students across the country. Each year we grant scholarships to about 1,300. That's the national-based and the campus-based. And then as you see here, like we talked about, they can be for 2, 3, or 4 years. Depending on the school you go to and the benefits they provide in addition, the scholarship money from us can be used for tuition or room or board, but many of the schools also will provide the other side of that payment to cover what your student has. So for example, when I received a 3-year scholarship out of high school, I showed up at my institution of higher learning. I said, my ROTC scholarship is paying for my tuition. The institution said, and we are picking up room and board because you're an Army ROTC scholarship. That is based on whichever school that your student goes to, but there are many places that will provide additional benefits if your student is a scholarship recipient. All right, and then as well as you can see, there is a book stipend that covers about $1,200 for books, and then a monthly stipend that does not just apply to scholarships, but once a cadet is contracted, once they've committed to the Army, they receive $420 a month for various fees and expenses that they have. All right, next slide. Okay, in addition to being the largest provider of scholarships within the United States, Army ROTC is the largest provider of Army officers. So you can see West Point provides about 12% of the Army's officers for every year group. OCS provides about 9%. And then you see the remaining chunks there. That's all ROTC. The other distinction is ROTC provides both active duty and reserve and guard officers. So if your student is not necessarily sure that he or she wants to participate as an active duty officer and may want to serve their state or the United States in a reserve or National Guard capacity, ROTC is probably the right route for them. Because as you heard Captain Dahl discuss the active duty commitment that comes with a West Point commission, our cadets graduate with an overall 8-year commission, but that's broken down. Those cadets who commission active duty will serve for 4 years active duty and then can transition for 4 years in the reserves or the individual ready reserves, which just means basically they're on call in case of national crisis. Our reserve students can graduate directly with a reserve or National Guard commission and continue their service through 1 weekend a month drill and then 2 weeks in the summer. But we overwhelmingly, the vast majority of Army officers come from Army ROTC. All right, next slide. All right, so you can see the distinction here between the number of applicants and the number of those selected between West Point and Cadet Command. That's what USAC stands for. Now, as Captain Dahl pointed out, West Point is very selective, very competitive. So it is they will take their pick, but we are able to grant scholarships and commissions to many more students who maybe just barely missed the cut in applying to West Point. And you can see the breakdown of kind of the distinction of how many valedictorians, how many team captains. Now, I believe Captain Dahl or several of the other briefers mentioned the qualities that we're looking for. I interview more high school students applying for scholarships than any other PMS in the country because of our proximity to Northern Virginia and the Capital Region. The criteria we are looking for are the same criteria of quality that West Point is looking for, in that we are told to look for qualities for a scholar, an athlete, and a leader. Those three things. Your student, if they want to be competitive for an Army ROTC scholarship, should be able to demonstrate that they are a well-rounded individual who succeeds to a certain extent in each of those three fields. They're academically sound, they participate in athletics, and that doesn't necessarily mean the football team or the lacrosse team. It could be competitive snowboarding. It shows that they have a competitive spirit and an athletic ability, and then that they participate in leadership activities, student government, Boy Scouts, church volunteer activities, etc. But we're still looking for those same general qualities. All right, next slide. Okay, so the benefits. As I discussed, you can get a 2, 3, or 4 year full college tuition and fees, or you can elect to have that cover room and board instead, up to $10,000 a year, depending on where you go and depending on the benefits that your school is offering you. That is an individual choice that may be the best for each. We also provide that $1,200 a year in textbooks and that $420 living allowance or stipends that I talked about. ROTC also has a separate mandate to commission Army nurses. For those students who are in the Army nurse program, we provide additional internship opportunities for them to get more hands-on and clinical hours than the average nursing student. And then we also pay for their NCLEX prep and their NCLEX testing fees that normal nursing students have to pay for out of pocket. Go ahead to the next slide. Okay, so the two standard scholarship types out of the national scholarship are the 4-year or the 3-year AD. 4-year scholarship recipients show up at campus and are immediately on, as soon as we contract them, they're immediately receiving their tuition benefits and their other benefits. A 3-year advanced designee is somewhat of a, for lack of a better way to put it, a probationary status. That student shows up and demonstrates that they are making the academic requirements that we lay out for them for that first year, and then we turn on their scholarship for their sophomore through senior years. All right, next slide. Okay, please skip over this. Sorry, I forgot this one was in here. These are just some opportunities that exist within our program. I'll talk a little bit more. Okay, hold here for a second and I'll talk a little bit more. So the difference between the service academies and ROTC is that we are a program that provides a path to commissioning at pre-existing universities that are distributed throughout the country. So as your student looks for the best fit for him or her as they seek higher education, each ROTC program will be slightly different and they will adapt to what that school has. You can see this picture here is taken from the woods that we have on George Mason. We're able to take our cadets out and do patrolling, do drills right there on campus. Other schools may have different programs. They have to do weekend drills. Our school, for example, being a civilian school, a more traditional civilian school, I have student athletes, I have members of student clubs, I have people who live off campus, I have people who live on campus. My personal experience, I was commissioned through the Virginia Military Institute, which was a very different experience than what my students have. So the day-to-day life of what ROTC is for your student will be most determined primarily by where they choose to go to school. But there are certain requirements that we have as far as week-to-week life for an ROTC student. The first thing is we will expect them to do physical training. My program, we do it 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, in the pre-COVID days. And we would basically, number one, make sure they're maintaining their level of physical fitness. But number two, integrate them into the Army culture of how we do physical training in the morning when they get out to a real Army unit. Number two, they will participate in their weekly military science level class. The freshmen, sophomores, juniors, seniors all meet with each other and discuss the topics that we have at hand for that level of education on their route to becoming an Army officer. And then number three, once a week, we participate in what we call lab, which is what you see here. It is basically, we come together with the program, all four levels of instruction, and conduct practical exercises about the things they've learned in the classroom, primarily built around leadership, development of operations orders, patrolling, et cetera. All right, next slide. And these are just some examples of some of our labs that we've done in the past. Okay, posterior, some prominent members, graduates from ROTC. So while West Point definitely provides, as the Captain Dahl pointed out, presidents, secretaries of defense, leaders for our country, ROTC does as well. So right there on the top left, I'd like to point out near and dear to my heart because he's a graduate of my alma mater, George C. Marshall, former chief of staff of the Army, who led the Army through World War II, was an ROTC graduate. General Gordon Sullivan, another chief of staff of the Army. Colin Powell, Secretary of State and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, ROTC graduate. Down at the bottom left, General Jack Keane, most recent recipient of the Presidential Medal of Freedom, ROTC graduate. The bottom right, General Mark Milley, the senior ranking military officer in the United States right now, is a graduate of ROTC. So ROTC provides general officer level leadership as well as leadership down to the tactical level for America's fighting Army. All right, next slide. Keep going, please. Please build. All right. Oh, sorry. Go back one. And then two that I want to point out in particular. Number one on the left, you see there, General Michael Bills, the commander of 8th Army, which is U.S. Army forces in Korea. This is near and dear to my heart because he is the senior ranking George Mason University ROTC officer. So three-star general, graduated from our program back in 1983. And then on the right, you see Patrick Murphy, who at the time in that picture was a captain in the 82nd Airborne Division. He and I served together in the 82nd when we invaded Iraq. He later became the acting secretary of the Army under the previous administration. So we have leaders at all levels, both in and out of uniform, who are provided or produced by ROTC. All right, next slide. All right, next slide, please. All right, so the biggest advice I can give you, because each cadet or student's path through ROTC might be slightly different, if you have questions, please reach out to our program. Mr. Frank Licamelli is our recruiting operations officer. He's a GS civilian. You can see our point of contact information right there. And then most importantly is the websites below. Particularly if you look at the website in the middle, that's our department website. It'll have our phone numbers and our addresses, our email addresses to reach us while we're all in COVID lockdown. If you have any questions about not only the George Mason program, but about ROTC in general. I appreciate appreciate everybody's welcome that we're able to speak to you. And I look forward to engaging with any of you who have any questions about ROTC. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carl. I appreciate your time. So in light of time constraints and respect for everyone's time, I'm going to go through quickly one question that has been asked multiple times on our Facebook Live. I know it was covered by Lieutenant Kohler as far as the Air Force goes, but from other academy standpoints, has there been any guidance given on SAT, ACT scoring as far as the admissions process goes?
Anthony, I would say for the Naval Academy that we're still waiting to see how COVID-19 is going to shape out in the president's direction.
Right up.
For the United States Military Academy, at this time, there's no change. We understand that all candidates are dealing with the same issues with the SAT and ACT, so they're still competing on an equal playing field. But we do understand that the SAT and ACT will be offering more opportunities in the fall for them to take those tests.
Good to go. I will say from a nomination standpoint, while our applications will still be due on October 1st, we are going to have flexibility on ACT, SAT scores. We haven't set a definitive date yet on when we'll have them due, but that will be put out with our furthering information. So Amir, if you can put up that last slide when you get a chance. So the majority of the questions that were posted on Facebook were answered today. If you are watching this on the recording and you run into questions that were not answered throughout these presentations, please feel free to reach out to me directly, or in my absence, I'll be on leave for a little while here. Reach out to our district director, Erica Campo. A few very important dates. May 1st, applications will be open and they will be available on wexton.house.gov/services/military-academy-nominations. There's also a frequently asked questions portal on there that will answer a lot of your questions about the nomination process. But again, I'm here to answer questions for you. If I'm not here, Erica will be. October 1st is our application deadline. We will again have flexibility in the ACT, SAT dates, and that information will follow. I thank all of you for joining us here today. If we can be of any assistance, please don't hesitate. And thank you to all our presenters.